Hey, welcome to week 7 of Paradox. If you have made it this far, I'm so glad to be on this journey with you. I hope the study guide has been helpful. I hope the series has been helpful. And if you're watching this in your small group, I hope you've had great discussion. Or if you're watching this in the series group that happens on campus or just later on in YouTube, I hope that this series has been really helpful for you as you discover the truth about you and God and the tension of contradiction. This is the last week. And I want to talk about something that's kind of interesting, maybe not the way you thought this series would end, but the way I've chosen it to end. I've got some good news, and I've got some bad news. Have you ever heard that phrase before? I remember hearing that as I sat on a table with a doctor who was kind of performing a way of finding out if I was going to need surgery or not. And so I may have told you this story before, but at one time I was a youth pastor and I kept getting pains in my stomach and I couldn't tell what it was. Honestly, for some time I thought it was just gas or I thought, you know, just I was having an allergic reaction to something. And one day the pain got so bad that I finally had to be driven to the hospital. And there was a huge, huge waiting room. A bunch of people were there. And about 20 minutes passed and the pain got so bad that I went up to the nurse and I said, hey, I'm gonna have to go home and lay down or go to a different hospital if I don't get seen soon. So can you please have someone see me? And she put me right in to a doctor and this doctor came and she said, lay on the table, and she pushed on my stomach and she said, I've got some good news and some bad news, you know? And I was like, okay, well, what is it? You know, what's the bad news? I wanted to receive the bad news first. And she said, the bad news is you have appendicitis. And so you're gonna have to get surgery. And I said, okay, what's the good news? She says, the good news is we can get you in 10 minutes. And I was surprised because I thought I was gonna go home. And I told her that. And I said, man, can we do this tomorrow? I've got youth group tonight. I wanna do this. And she said, if you go and do this tomorrow, you'll wake up dead. And so I was like, let's do this surgery. This is awesome. So that phrase, good news and bad news, you probably heard it before. In fact, there was a study not too long ago done that some people prefer the bad news or the good news depending on whether you're giving or receiving. Most people, when they're giving news, they want to give you the good news first. They want to soften us up. They want to tell us the good thing first so we don't kill the messenger, in a sense. But if you're receiving news, most of us want to get bad news first. We want to end on something good. In fact, in your small group today, or if you're just talking with yourself or a friend or your series group, you should ask this question: which would you rather receive, the bad news or the good news first? And which would you rather give, the good news or the bad news first? And you'll be surprised that people will have different opinions. Now, the paradox I want to talk about today is the final paradox in our series. It's paradox number 7, that God's news for the world is bad for good people and good for bad people. And the reason that's a paradox is you would think that good people get good news and bad people get bad news, that it's a product of their lifestyle, their choices, their attitudes, their actions towards other people, and ultimately towards God. But that's actually not the way that God's news works. In fact, the Apostle Paul writes this huge treatise on the human condition in the book of Romans. And the first 5 chapters are incredibly challenging for people to realize how bad of a person they really are. I mean, Paul takes from a bunch of different places in Scripture, and he essentially says, you're not a good person. You're not even close. He uses all these ways to describe that our throats are open graves, that we've never done anything good in our lives, that no one is good but God alone. Congratulations, you suck. But I do too, and so does the world. And if you stopped there, you would think that this isn't good news at all. Why do Christians call the evangelistic tool, that is the death and resurrection of Jesus, as good news? That doesn't sound good. What's interesting about it is what Paul wants to get at is he wants people to understand there is no such thing as a good person. And that's important because you may think you're a good person. There was a time in my life where I thought I was a good person. And for the world, they want to be known as good people. They want to do good, they want to be good, and oftentimes people consider themselves as good. And what Paul does is he tells the world in no uncertain terms, there is nothing about you that is good. That's the bad news for good people. In the biblical sense, the word we would use for this is righteousness. It's good moral standing. It's your standing between you and God. And it's something that a lot of us try to achieve if we don't have Christ at the center of our lives ourselves. And Paul knew this. Paul knew this really well. And even if you're not a religious person, maybe you don't even believe in God, you think that the way for you to be good is by your own standards. And the day you think that you are good, you believe it, and you tell people you are. And what Paul wanted us to address is the fact that God's standards says that we are not good people. In fact, Paul, who was a Pharisee, who was a person who had God's law, thought that it was purposeful in helping people become in a good standing relationship with God. But he realized when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus that God's standards were actually meant to point out that Paul and his constituents and you and I and the world, according to God's standards, were not good. And it was important to understand that. You know, when you go to the doctors, you remember when I went earlier, if you don't get the bad news first, you can't understand how good the good news is. You know, the bad news is you have appendicitis. The good news is it's operable, it's curable. And God saved the best news for last. He had bad news for good people and good news for bad people. And the good news for bad people is God came to save people like you and like me and the world through his Son. He wanted the world to know that no one was good, but God is good. God wanted the world to know that he knows that we have offended him. We have turned our backs on him. We could spit in his face with our actions and our actions and treatment of other people. We're not good. And God absolutely knows that. And he wants us to know that he knows that. And he wants us to know that he came for bad people like us. If there is only one person who is good, and that is good alone, God alone, then he has done something good and incredibly valuable for us. Now, I want to talk real quick about this idea of justice, mercy, and grace, because God has all three of those. And I want to use a piece of fruit. It's almost Halloween here, so I'm going to use a pumpkin. You know, in some parts of the world, if you steal a piece of fruit, there is a consequence. In fact, no, it's actually not big enough. Let's get this guy. There is a consequence in some parts of the world. In some parts of the world, still today, not just in ancient times, in fact, if you go to Iran today, they still have this kind of a punishment. That if you were to steal a piece of fruit, they could take off four of your fingers or your wrist. It's crazy, right? That's not first century stuff. That's 21st century stuff. And that's the idea of justice, is that if you were to break one of God's laws, which is thievery, you lose something. In the Old Testament, it was an eye for an eye. If you chose to steal or harm someone else, you had to give back an equal measure. It was part of their Old Testament law, and it changed over the years, but the basics of it were if you wronged someone, you had to be wronged in turn in order to make up the difference. And so that was the idea of justice, getting what you deserve. And then there's this idea of mercy. Let's say a person stole this piece of food, and they come to the authorities, and the authorities have the right to use a weapon on them. And the authorities, or maybe God in this instance, says, you know what? I'm going to pardon you. I'm going to be merciful to you. I am not going to use the justice that you are due. I am going to say, you go free. You don't get anything, but you don't have to suffer the punishment. And then there's the third part. So that's God's justice and God's mercy. And then there's the third part, God's grace. And grace is completely different. Because in this scenario, someone steals a piece of food. And they have what most people think of as only two options. You can give them the penalty, which is to lose one of their hands. Or you can give them mercy, which is to spare them any calamity or any hardship or any penalty. But God gives us a third option. He says, not only that, I'm going to give you a basket of fruit. I'm going to give you more than you deserve. I'm going to give you something that not only do you believe that is too good for you, but it is too good for you. You deserve my justice or you deserve my mercy, but you do not deserve my grace. And this is what makes the life and the good news of Jesus so incredible, Paul says that while we were still sinners, while we were still enemies, sinning is not a mistake. You make a mistake when you don't turn the right way and you're trying to get home. A sin is something you do that you know you should not do, that God does not say, that God says something about that is wrong, and you do it anyways. Paul says, while we were enemies of God, God died for us, for you and I. And he gave us eternal life, the option for eternal life. He gave us his grace, something you and I don't deserve. That's the good news. The bad news is you and I do not deserve it. The good news is that God willingly wants to give it to you through his son. I hope this has been helpful. I want to give you some small group questions. I'm sure you have a ton to talk about. And some of you are going to Google if you can actually lose your hand. You can still today. I want to give you a couple things to think about. The first one is, have you ever thought about yourself as a good person? Have you ever had a family member say that? What makes you, or what do you think makes them, think of themselves as a good person? Whose standard is it? Yours? Is it God's or someone else? How do you reflect on that? And that's the first question. The second one is, why do you think God gave the law? Because if the law in the Old Testament was God's ultimate standards, why would he give that if he knew that you and I could not abide by it? Why would he do that? Hope you have a good time, either talking with someone near you in your series group or in your small group. It's been my pleasure to be with you these 7 weeks. Thank you so much. You're already blessed in Christ. We'll see you either online or on a Sunday. Have a great day.